I want to talk to design systems on how I learn to stop worrying and solve the chaos. So now we already know that there are no other designers here. And you have all been through times when you got a mock-up or something and there were like 10 shades of blue for buttons. Have you been through times like that when you just wanted to put a lot of salt in your designer's coffee? Okay, awesome. So that's not only my test. In a lot of product and service companies, different stakeholders are like at war with each other. It's like they are sitting on a ticking time bomb. This talk is named after a satire called Dr. Strange Love. It was made by one of the finest directors of our time. Stanley Kubrick. The backdrop of the movie was Cold War between Russia and America. They weren't very friendly at that time, like they are now. It was about an impending nuclear war. Our companies or different stakeholders like design, dev, testers, managers, we are often in a similar situation. Like we are in a cold war over the product. And what actual product gets shipped outside to the user, right? Everyone is putting things in their side. Managers want one thing, devs want to do it one way, and designers, they always have some problem about, like they mentioned, font weights and colors of the fonts. It's like we are in our own Game of Thrones. We have our own House Lannisters, House Starks, and on top of everyone, our managers or our white walkers. So, my name is Tejas. I've been a designer for over 8 years now, and I've been in this type of situations many times in my career so far, where we are in a cold war. There is one designer with 15 developers. Things are running very fast. Devs just start designing everything on their own. There's a communication breakdown, and the product suffers in the end. Over the years, last 3 or 4 years, I started to work in on a concept or in a method called design systems, and this is about my learnings from over the last few years creating design systems, which have now helped me create much more effective communication around the product and product design, which also helps devs and other team members. But before that, my halat was like this. I don't know if you can see this very well, but I was saying beta dualism ye ho kya raha hai. So let's define design systems. When we say design systems, what do we mean by that? What are design systems? Design systems are a documentation of principles, rules, and ideas that guide the entire product team into building the product. So it's not thinking about the product in terms of flows or screen by screen, which sadly most of us have already been doing, right? We think of features and everything in terms of one or another flow, but we take everything screen by screen. Okay, this screen, this screen is done. We don't think of it as a whole product. Design system is kind of documenting in a way so that you have a coherent product instead of different components or different modules. Modularity is not really a new concept in either programming or design. We have been using modular code or modular frameworks like Bootstrap or the Foundation. Or if you go back even a few years more, something like jQuery UI or Yahoo UI library. These kind of things we have been using for a long time. So these kind of frameworks, they are pre-tested, cross-browser tested library of components, which you can take, you can assemble them in some way to create your own products. What they lack is sort of a documentation, sort of a logic or rationale on how to use particular components to build your own product, how to contextualize those components. Bootstrap does get a lot of rap from people for standardizing or making everything look same, but even companies like Airbnb, did, and they still do use Bootstrap. So if you are using Bootstrap, you don't have to blame yourself at all. Companies with, who have made name for their design, they also use Bootstrap. There's nothing wrong with it. So if we take components, the metaphor of Lego blocks for your components, let's say your component library is a set of Lego blocks, then you can think of design systems as the guidebook that tells you how to make something from that Lego box. You can make a starship or a Lord of the Rings castle, Moria castle or anything, only if you have that guidebook. It tells you how to put your pieces together to build something out of it. So, moving into the components or the ingredients of a design system. What are design systems made of? First and foremost and most important thing in a design system is the core principles of your product design. You take your design decisions or principles, what you want your product to be based on, and then use your design system as the melting pot for those concepts and your principles. So to give you an example, this is from material design. Have people here use material design or are familiar? Yes. Okay, awesome. Great. So material design has laid down their principles up front. They want to use material as a metaphor for their product design. They want to make their app, at least Google's own apps, very bold and graphical. They want to make it very colorful. And motion is a very integral part of design to kind of add a meaning, to give proper feedback to the users about different activities on the screen. Next is content. Content is what we communicate through our products to the users, right? It could be in terms of written words, written phrases, or could be visual elements, media elements. Here's an example from a popular product called MailChimp. So MailChimp has they have a dedicated website for how to use text messages in their products, in their app. They have defined, and anyone in the design system, you can define what your messages to the user should be, how to actually label, it could be even as detailed as how to label your call to action buttons, right? How concise you want your messages to be, whether you want your messages to be humorous or you want to make them very straightforward, and then you can also define and declare inclusivity in your content, right? So for example, use of gender pronouns. That's a huge point of debate everywhere, how to use the gender pronouns in apps, where you may have seen she being used more often in order to make it more inclusive to women, right? So similar things, they get defined in your content. Images, do people here remember images like this when they were a norm on web? I mean, you go to a company's website, company might be based out of Ahmedabad or Hyderabad or Mumbai, but everyone would use these type of images on their website. Call it a lack of proper stock images or awareness, but there was a time when everything looked like this. Products have kind of moved on from then. We have started defining our images to be more inclusive, candid, diverse. You might have seen lots and lots of products. They have clear definition about what type of images should go in their product. And there are more technical things you can define in design system, like what image sizes should be there, what resolution should be used, and things like that. Because images convey your values in ways that words cannot. You can immediately speak to the user that, okay, you are the target or you are not. Similarly, illustrations, you can define your illustration styles, specifications in your design system. This is an example of illustrations done over Dropbox, and it's completely whimsical and fantastical, things that may not happen. And that really conveys what Dropbox was trying to do like 7-8 years ago when they started. what kind of direction they wanted their product to convey. So just to take a step aside and ask a question, we are designers and I'm a designer. Most of you are front-end devs. Why do we need to talk about content? Isn't content someone else's job, right? Someone in the company who we haven't seen ever. Don't they write the content? I would say no, because as creators of digital products, our job is to serve content in the best way, the best content in the best way to the users, right? That's what our products are for, to serve some sort of content to the users. Secondly, when you work on content with other people in the company, say someone from HR or marketing or from legal, it breaks down the ecosystem that we have created in tech system. It's in tech ecosystem, it's like all the technical people are talking to each other, but our users are someone completely different. They don't share the same background. They don't share the same skills. When you work with cross-functional teams, you help break that echo chamber down. Which is why I think content is one thing where everyone in your company should collaborate on and work together. Typography. Typographic system like selection of typefaces or scale, the rhythm, vertical rhythm. That's very important for any kind of product, because a lot of web or apps is text to be read. Colors, again, your color palette conveys the values of your brand to the users. In your design system, you can not only choose your colors, but also specify the color combinations. You can also specifically work for accessibility. For people with different vision abilities who don't have perfect vision, and then a lot of us here are, when we don't even realize that we are color blind, right? So accessibility is also a very important thing that should be defined at the outset in your design systems. Here's an example from IBM's Carbon Design System. They have picked a color and kind of combination which enhances text and keeps text legible at all the layers. Grid and structure. Your product can choose to use a grid with multiple columns or anything, or you can just do away with it. In the context of your product, whatever makes sense. You can also define how your grid or structure should respond to different screen sizes. You can use your grid to establish a baseline or vertical rhythm. So people who are familiar with material design, you might know that they work at a baseline of 4 points, right? So all your elements and components are placed, and they are multiples or multipliers of 4. So those type of things, the baseline, you can define. Another example from Carbon Design, you see how the grid responds to the screen size changes. Earlier you had 12 columns and a certain gutter. When you move to a smaller screen, you change the number of columns and gutter as well. This is an example of how baseline grid works. You pick a baseline, and then all your elements can sit on that page. Component sheet. Component sheet or component library is something a lot of you might be familiar with. You might even be using something like this in your organization. A component library is your catalog of all the UI elements that go into your product. So you can define all your elements and how they are related with each other. A form input field is placed, how the next label should be placed, things like that. You can define their structure, specs, and their behavior, in the sense that how an element looks when it is focused versus active versus disabled. You can also define states of larger entities, for example, something like empty state, how something looks when there is no data in it, or how something would look when a user is using it for the very first time. how do you actually drive the user to take some actions. Those type of states can also be defined in your design systems. Data visualizations. Again, if your product uses a lot of data visualization, you can create definitions for them. Your charts, graphs, infographics. Here is an example of a pie chart and how values are kind of denoted by color and what order they go into. So, to summarize, your design system is made of your four principles. Your definition and declaration of above content, grid and structure, typography, colors, your component library, data visualization and tools for that. You can even add things like icons. If your product is very much dependent on animation, you can create rules for motion design as well. So your principles of motion design can also be part of the design system. So going back, to how I started the talk. Why do we need design system? I mean, one thing I mentioned was communication. Make the communication manner, right? But say you don't have that problem. Your product probably runs very smooth. You don't have fights between designers and devs after 5 p.m. every evening, right? Do you still need a design system? So that's the case I'm trying to make now. Communication, as I mentioned before, communication is very important between different team members, not only designers and devs, but once you have developed something, that work is going to be the testers. Do testers understand what you are trying to make, right? And I think all of you will agree that that's a huge problem, getting something past the testing, right? So when you create a design system, you are essentially creating a shared language between all your different stakeholders, all your different departments. Which means that when I, a designer, mention something, you know exactly what I'm talking about, the tester knows exactly what we are talking about, and you can even extend that to the customer, to the end user, so they know what you are talking about. When you create a design system in this type of shared language, as devs, you can be sure that there won't be any surprises. You won't get a new screen with 15 buttons, all of different shapes. You know that there is something I already know about this product, and the new work is going to be based on that. These type of constraints make lives very easy. Believe me when I say this, when you know exactly what kind of large pool you are getting things from, your work is becomes very easy and kind of happier. So, to give you an example of how the shared language works, this is something from a product called Intercom. Some of you might have heard or used this product. It's a chatbot you can place on websites, right? So in their definition, in their feature definition, they use a name, they use a phrase for a feature, which then translates into their sketch file, right? So from definition to design, they have a component in code for the same, which I am not very sure, but could be React. So they have the same thing in their component library, core component library, and then when a user searches for something on the website, that's also in the same language. Users are also searching for conversation. So from start to finish, everyone is using the same language. Their vocabulary is same. Which means you have happy designers, devs, testers and managers, good vibes and happy users. Scalability. When you have a shared resource, when you have created a pool of resources as part of design system, that makes it very easy for product teams to go from idea to production. You can create wireframes, start picking different components based on the rules you have already set and start building screens very quickly. Which means that your turnaround time from having an idea for a feature or something, I mean, this is assuming you have done your research and you have proper structure or flow in mind. So from having, from that moment, from that eureka moment, to getting to a production version of that feature, the turnaround time is very low. And low turnaround time is a honey to ears of your managers. because it means you are saving a lot, lots of money. You are saving lots of money going from idea to production. Knowledge sharing and consistency in output. So, because you have documentation, it becomes very easy to share the knowledge between other team members, between team members of your own department, from designers to designers, and designers to devs. All the knowledge sharing becomes very easy. It also means that there is a consistency in the output. Two or three people working on two multiple modules, you can be sure that their result is going to be same because it's based off the same source of truth. Right? It allows cross-functional teams to see rationale behind design. How many of you here think that design is some sort of magic and you have no idea how your designers come up with the stuff they do, but you are just supposed to take their deliverables and work on it? Have you ever been in a situation where your designer refuses to tell you why they made certain choices, right? Why their choices are like that, but you are just supposed to work on them? You all come from really great companies. Okay, so what I've seen from a lot of clients, a lot of teams, is that designers, they seem to think like design is some sort of black box in which magical things happen, because there's no transparency. As designers, we have been guilty of not being very transparent about our processes and how we come to certain conclusions and how we build certain solutions. When we create design systems and we document that rationale and that logic, it makes it very easy for other people to understand our process. Then it makes design not a black box, it looks like something that can be easily learned. Right? It's not an art or talent you are born with, it's something that can be learned. Because it's logical. It also makes it very easy for new team members to become productive. If you are a senior team member in your team, whether a designer or a developer, do you have young new joinees coming up to you and asking questions about why something is like that or that? No one? So no one has any new joinees coming up to them asking questions? Okay, so at least it happens with the design teams. New designers come and ask us questions. Why something is like this? How do they repeat the same thing? How do they create something similar? When you have a design system, when you have documented your principles and rationale behind it, the new team members can read and see all those things and they become productive very quickly. Their ramp up time to becoming productive reduces a lot, which means you have very happy news in the team. They know what exactly how they are going to build something. Response to external changes. So, based on an article by a company called Information Architects, there are 14,290 Android devices in the market, which means a huge spectrum of device screen sizes. We are never going to be able to build anything, design, develop, and test anything across the spectrum, right? There are, and this is only device phones. Think about other things: your laptops, tablets, phablets, VR glasses, right? TVs, advertisement screens. The screenverse is—it's like a multiverse. It's larger than Marvel's universe. So, what you can do is instead of designing and developing for everything, you can set rules as to how your system, how your product responds to screen size changes. So here is an example from material design again. Something that's a tooltip or a dialog box on larger screen, they have defined it as a bottom sheet in smaller screens. So you just have to define something like this. You don't have to create each and everything separately. You have created your component. At a component level, you have defined how it's supposed to behave when screen size changes. So, device to device, you are in a better section. Concurrent design. Because now you have a shared resource, you have everything documented. Multiple teams can start working on different modules, different features at the same time. And the surety is that they are going to work of a shared DNA of the product. you have one team working on one feature, the other team can pick up a different feature, and their work will be consistent in their output. So, together, everyone can work. How many people here know what imposter syndrome means? Okay, I'll define it for you and then ask again. So, imposter syndrome means that you are able to do something, but you cannot actually believe that you are good at it, whether it's development or design. Now, how many people feel this on a regular basis? Okay, I thought so too, because I am like you. So when you are not able to actually believe that you are good at doing what you are doing, often it is not because lack of confidence. I mean, it could be because of lack of confidence, but it is also because when you take certain decisions on your day-to-day basis, you are taking them based on internalized processes and intuition, right? You are not externally documented your rationale behind it. Some of the decisions come automatically to you. So you start feeling that, okay, you might be doing a lot better than you did 6 months ago, but you are not able to feel it. When you document something, when you write it down, when you write down the rationale and step-by-step process behind your decisions, you are able to feel that, no, there was something, there was some logic behind what I did. It helps to cure your imposter syndrome. You start feeling better. And completely based on anecdotal evidence of one person, which is me, I would recommend you try this, documenting your processes, because you start feeling much better at whatever you do. So, you feel good about what you are doing. So just to summarize, and these are only a few benefits that I've personally experienced from creating design systems. It improves the communication between different teams and makes for happy team members. Unlike, I would rather take guarantee that it will improve your relationship with your designer. It makes knowledge sharing easy and makes it very easy for the new team members to learn something about the product. You can define your responsiveness of the product. Multiple teams can design together and it can cure your imposter syndrome. So, picture is not all rosy. It's not as if you can start, you learn about design system today and tomorrow or Monday morning, you're going to start creating and using it. One of the biggest challenge in creating or implementing design systems is that it takes time to create design systems and then maintain them. Because it's a living document, right? You are going to make changes based on implementation and on research, on data, how people are using your features. You are going to have to go back and make changes to your design system. It takes time, it takes people power to do it, which often companies are not really interested in investing into. Top level buy-in. For a manager, a lot of times, managers and the top management would rather spend the time, money, and energy on developing new features than something like a design system. Because design system may or may not give you any immediate benefit. A lot of the promises are future benefits, like, okay, you can scale better, your product will be more coherent, your product will be actually better. But trading that for two new features that can go out next week or Wednesday, depending on the manager, that's very hard buy-in to get, right? So, convincing the top management to invest their time and energy into this is sort of hard. Lack of tools. So, until very recently, there were no decent tools for designers to create design systems. So, normally, the way designers would work is they would make two copies of the same resources file, Photoshop or Sketch, make changes. At the end of their work, they would collate everything together. There were no Git-like workflows for designers. That has changed now a lot because most of the design tools now support design systems and libraries out of the box. Here's an example of a design system I made for a company called WebEngage, which is based out of Mumbai. You saw more examples of web engineers design systems here also. This is a specific one because the audience for this design system was their designers, web engineers' own designers. It's a little more specific in terms of giving out specs and different states and everything. A lot of times, this spec part is automated, so any designer doesn't have to create it from scratch. Here's a very different example of using design system for theming. So there's a company in Bangalore which has created a product called Wallet Money, which different financial institutes can white label and convert into their own product. So here's one screen. This is the vanilla theme for Wallet Money. It is based out of a based on a design system that we created. Then we, when we had to make subtle changes, small changes to make a different product, we simply changed some components or some basic rules in the design system, like typographic colors and little bit of grid. And the another product is discernibly different. It's not entirely different, but there are differences so that they could be sold to two different companies. So side by side, these are based on the same things with changes at the design system level, which means theming is very easy. Once you have defined something, your theming becomes very easy, which is a huge asset to service-based companies or even product-based companies, that you can change certain things and create an entirely new product. There are examples of design systems out there: Salesforce, MailChimp, Shopify, IBM. Google is the one who started this all. So Google's Google guidelines. Acacia has a design system which you can study to kind of start on your own and see how they contextualize everything in terms of their own product. It has become so popular that now there is a gallery for design systems. When something has a gallery, you know that it has arrived. So the question I want to leave you with is how can you or your organization use design systems? How can you go and ask your designers to kind of take these rules, take this concept, make it so that it suits the context of what you are building, and come up with documenting their rationale, their decisions, in a way so that it makes it easy for you. You are the, for any design, front-end devs or devs are the very first customers. It goes to users afterwards. So you are the first people who get to see your design, right? And build something based on that. What I would request you to do is go and think how these concepts apply to your product. How can you ask your designers to use them? That's the end of my talk. If you have any questions, you can either ask me on Twitter or my email address or outside. Thank you very much.